If I ask you who is one of the most successful investors in the Indian stock market, I feel the answer would be Rakesh Jhunjhunwala. Of course, I understand that there are many, many more successful investors as well, but I'm naming him because he's a chartered accountant. But then you can imagine from whom he would have learned certain lessons about the stock market. The name is none other than Mr. Radhakishan Damani. What fun it would be if such a person, such a great investor, starts a company and people like you and me get an opportunity to invest into that company. Do you know which company I'm talking about? Hi guys, CA Rachana Ranade here, and I welcome you all to my Fundamental Analysis lecture series. Many of you had requested me to make a separate lecture on fundamental analysis of DMart, and that's why I've come up with this video. To start off, why this company was started, Mr. Damani, who was and who is one of the most successful investors in the stock market, he thought that why not make or why not start a company which itself becomes a success story, and why not allow people like you and me, other investors, to invest in this success story. This was the dream. One more dream with which he started DMart was providing best quality consumer products, and that too at the lowest possible price. To take this dream forward, he first went to the United States of America and he tried to study how Walmart and other few retail chains work in USA. He studied that very carefully, came back to India, thought of modifying this in the Indian context, and then he and his team opened the first retail store in Maharashtra. Today, it is operating in almost 11 states and one union territory. So let's understand how DMart is different from other retail stores. Number one, what they have focused on is the very first one is that DMart actually owns a lot of properties while they start new shops. So let us understand. Possibility number one, they'll buy land and then they'll construct a shop. Possibility number two, they'll buy a shop. They are not more into the renting model as of now. So what happens in the initial stages? The growth could be a little bit slow because the moment they generate cash, the moment they generate more and more profits, it has to be invested in a fixed property again to buy new house, to buy new shops and to purchase new land. But slowly and steadily, as and how they are able to generate more and more profit from the existing shops, then the profitability keeps on increasing rapidly. Okay, so the very first is how they are different is they have more and more land as well as shops. Second one is cash discount. I read a blog which said that other retailers like Future Retail and all other supermarket chains, they generally make a delayed payment. Delayed payment is as in like 20 days, 21 days. But then DMart generally pays pretty quickly, like maybe in less than a week to its suppliers. So it is for sure that if they're paying pretty quickly, then the suppliers would give them a cash discount. So that is a powerful tool with them, that because they are getting a cash discount, a small portion of that they can give it to people like you and me who are the customers, and that is how they can offer discounts on the products which are kept in the supermarket. The third one is trade discount. Now here what happens is that because they have a huge footfall in the supermarket, the number of quantity of products which is sold is very high. Because the quantity sold is very high, they need products at a very high volume. So whenever they buy products from various suppliers, they won't buy like 5, 10, 15 quantity. They would go in hundreds of quantity. So the moment you are buying in hundreds of quantity, then you get a discount known as a trade discount, also known as a volume discount. So again, understand, if they are getting X rupees as a volume discount, some portion of that, again, they can pass on to the customers. So two discounts they were able to pass on to the customers. Number one, cash discount, a small part of that. Number two, trade discount, a part of that. This is how they are able to sell at a price below MRP, but still earn profit. There are a few more discounts through which they can actually benefit. I'll take you to one point and then I'll go back to the point which I was talking about. Slotting fees. This is one more reason why DMart is able to sell products at a lower price. So it's beneficial for me and still they are in profit. How does that happen? So they charge a slotting fee to many of the manufacturers. Now, what is that? They say that if you want to sell your product in DMart, you have to pay me a fee. Okay, now this is something different. So let's take an example of a Kirana store. Let's say that the company wants to sell its products in a Kirana store or in a stationery shop or wherever. in that case, do you think that the kirana store or the stationery shop will demand a fee from the manufacturer that you pay us money and then only we will display our products? This will never happen. But that is what exactly DMart does. They will say that if you want to sell products with me, I'm going to charge you a slotting fee. This is point number one. So let us say they are charging a slotting fee of, let us say, 50,000. I'm taking this as a random number. Now, out of this 50,000, again, they can keep, let us say, 30,000-40,000 with themselves, and 10,000 they can again pass on a discount to people like you and me. So that's how we are getting good discounts at DMart. Still, they are earning a profit. I'll tell you one more point. There is also one fee which is charged many of the times for positioning of the product. A study has shown that any product which is at the eye level is sold more than any product which is kept at the foot level. Obviously, it is so simple, so logical. Even you might have seen that in many of the retail stores, the chocolates or anything which kids would definitely like is generally placed near the billing counter. So whenever there are large queues, you know what the kids are going to do? Mummy, chocolate! And that is why the parents are going to fall for the, you know, all this stuff children are going to do. And they're going to buy these chocolates for them. So that's how the sale again increases. So they are doing a lot of tactics of product positioning, slotting, cash discount, volume discount, everything. They are gaining a lot of discount and a small part of that is being passed on to us, right? Still, we are benefiting. One more way how they are benefiting. They are selling products with their own branding. Now, what they do is they try to study which products are sold more often. Now, let us say I'm talking about a broomstick, okay? And if a broomstick is being sold with a good volume, then what they could do is manufacture their own broom with the branding of DMart. Okay, now here, the pricing is in the control of DMart. But if they are selling a broomstick of some other company, pricing is not under their control. Not to a huge extent, to a small extent. But if they are branding it, or they are manufacturing it by themselves, they are branding it with their own brand, then definitely price is in their control. So this is one more big advantage. In fact, they have started doing this branding with many products, with many different brands like DMart Minimax, DMart Premia, DMart Homes, Dutch Harbor, so many brands they are building as their own branding. Okay, these are major points. Few more points are like they rely on local supplies rather than far off suppliers, so that their supply chain itself is cut down. Their reach is right now at 112 locations of the country with 191 stores at present. And of course, they give an importance to regional products as well. So I'll give you an example. Like if Pune's Bakarwadi is very famous, okay, then such famous food items or such famous products will be placed in their store so that again, the sale of such products is increased. Let's talk about the fundamental analysis part for DMart. First, we're going to talk about certain balance sheet analysis point and then we'll go on to the valuations of the company. The very first point we should check is top line, bottom line. Top line is sales growth, bottom line is PAT growth. Okay, here if you check out, I'm giving it in a chart format. The revenue from operations has grown very steadily from 14-15 till 18-19. Currently, it is at 19,916, of course, in crores, which was barely 6,000 crores in 14-15. So the revenue is increasing constantly. PAT is also increasing at a rate of 19% YOY is year on year. Year on year, it is increasing by 19%. From 211 crores, it has gone up to 936 crores. EBITDA, which is again a very important factor. EBITDA is earnings before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization. By the way, if you are not familiar with these terms, I have a separate lecture series on fundamental analysis, which is a paid version, of course. You can check out my website, www.rachanaranade.in. Not right now. First, watch the full video and then go to my website. Okay. So EBITDA is also growing at a very good pace of 23% from 454 crores to 1642 crores. A very important ratio here I would like to make a note of is fixed assets turnover ratio. I have not explained this ratio till date in my video lecture. So let me just tell you how this is calculated. This is your turnover divided by your fixed assets. Okay, so please understand. Higher this ratio, so if it is growing from 4 to 4.4, then it means that with X number of fixed assets, you are able to generate more turnover. Okay, so let us say if it is 4, then what would it be? By investing 100 rupees in fixed assets, they are able to generate a turnover of 400. That is how the fixed asset ratio would come up to 4. If with 100 rupees of fixed asset, you are able to generate 800 rupees turnover, then it will be 8. Okay, so more and more this ratio increases, it means that you are utilizing your fixed assets very efficiently. And with the same fixed assets, let us say you are able to generate more and more of turnover. It's more or less increasing by not a great percentage, but still they're doing pretty good. Okay, so that is about the basic fundamental analysis. As far as the P&L is concerned, when we talk about PAT, we talk about EBITDA, we talk about sales, and one more ratio I introduced for the first time today, that is fixed assets turnover ratio. Few more fundamental analysis points. Here, let's talk about how much revenue they are generating from per square foot area. If you remember, in the beginning of the video only I talked about this, they believe in space optimization. With lesser space, generate more and more revenue. So higher, the better. So this has again grown at 9% year on year. From 26,000, it has grown up to roughly 35,000. Retail business area is also increasing. It means that more and more outlets, they are increasing. The space in which they are operating, that is increasing. Cumulative number of stores is increasing. I told you right now, they are at 191. And very important is total bill cuts. I hope you understood about the basic fundamental analysis. You might have seen in many of my previous videos on fundamental analysis, I used to show you the screen of Money Control. Then, I guess just 2-3 weeks ago, Ticker Tape, which is one of the websites, I can say it's pretty similar to Money Control, they contacted me and they said that, could you show our portal instead of showing Money Control portal? And I'm thankful to them because they have sponsored this part of the video. I also personally felt that visually, in many aspects, it is a tad better than Money Control because I get to understand few points pretty quickly as compared to Money Control. In fact, I also was able to understand that some parts of data which are not pretty easily available on Money Control, it's right there in the overview itself. So I'll give you the valuation perspective. The very first point is PE matrix. Okay, so what is a PE? PE is price earning ratio. I've made a separate video on that as well. See, PE is 120 for DMart. It's like extremely high. I know that it is performing very well. Sales are at a very high rate. As compared to its peers, it's doing way better than its peers. But please check out the sector PE, that is the industry PE. It is 42 and it's almost at 3 times of the industry PE. So it's pretty expensive. If I talk about PB, price to book value, it is 19, whereas the sector PB is 10. So again, double of that. Again, I was not able to see sector PB very easily in other sites like Money Control. So I thought this is a very big advantage. I can also compare sectoral PB, that is industrial PB, with the company's PB. So these were the two very important points for valuation perspective. One important point, again, I would like to tell you is about the financials and income. You can see that they have just simplified it. So everyone can see this revenue, gross profit everywhere. You can see this in any website. But they are just giving you a snapshot, a very crisp thing saying that this is higher than industry revenue growth. So over the last 5 years, revenue has grown at a yearly rate of 33% versus the industry average of 31%. So they are giving quite interesting statistics. So they're comparing company with the industry. Similarly, in market share, over the last 5 years, market share has increased from 41% to 44%. They're almost claiming like almost half of the total market share of entire retail sector. Okay, so I was in the overview, then financial, it has a lot of data. I'm moving on to the holdings point. Again, this is given in a very nice fashion in a graphical point. Here you can see total promoters holding is 80%, mutual fund holding 4%, domestic holding 4%, foreign institutional investors 6%, other parties 9% roughly. Okay, again, they give their own commentary here that total promoter holding is almost constant, mutual fund holding is almost constant, same about FIIs. I'll tell you a big problem here now for DMart. If you know this, as per SEBI norms, the maximum promoter holding should be 75%. They are still 5% above the holding, above the norms of SEBI. It's not a non-compliance, but they have to lower down this percentage in the near future. Do you know what has happened with HDFC AMC very recently? The stock has corrected by a huge amount. Almost, if I'm not mistaken, it is a 15 to 20% correction in a very short span. Why did this happen? Same problem. Because HDFC AMC also had a promoter holding above 75% and they had to sell off that part to comply with SEBI guidelines. Exactly same is going to happen with DMart. They'll have to sell off their additional promoter stake. When? They have not yet disclosed. So even I don't know about that. But in the near future, they'll have to do that. See, the moment the promoter sells their stake, definitely supply will be more than demand and the price is going to drop. So that is it about the holdings. And one last point I would like to tell you is about the events. In events, they are one more point they can say that dividend trend, for example, many people invest so that they can get or earn higher dividends. Again, they have given in a snapshot that DMart has not given any dividend in the last 5 years. So since listing, not even a single rupee of dividend given. Okay, so we just talked about the fundamental analysis, but I just thought that it would be great if I do a fundamental analysis of a particular stock and a technical analysis for the same stock. I just browsed through many YouTube videos, but I found very few YouTube videos which do both. It could be either a fundamental or a technical. So I thought, let me just give this a shot, that I should try to do the analysis for both. I think this could be a much, much more meaningful analysis for you. So I've just typed out Avenue Supermarkets in in.tradingview.com. It's a free website. I'm here going to the full feature chart. All right. So what I've done is it's a normal daily candlestick chart. Okay. So if I were to check what are the resistance levels, just try to draw a resistance line here first. Okay. So this is a pretty old data. It's like August 2018 that I'm talking about. Yeah, fair enough. So I think there should be a good range for data. So I'm trying to draw a resistance line right here. So as I mentioned, try to cut least candles, if not even one, that'll be great. But like this candle, if you just check on screen, it's like one of the candles which broke the resistance, and then that's why the momentum has been seen. So 1, 2, 3, 4 points connected. This acted as a resistance, but the moment the resistance was broken, then ideally it should act as a support. And what amazing thing can you see here? Just check this out. In the recent past, it tested this level, it bounced back, and right now, today is 18th December, I'm shooting the video, and this candlestick is not yet fully formed because this is what is happening today. This is what had happened yesterday, okay? So you can see a very big bull candle, and this has been seen after taking a good support here at this level of the support level. Let's try to draw one more support. So always remember that the support or resistance need not be in a horizontal line. It could also be in something like this. So again, if you can see here, 2, 3, more than that points were joined, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points joined, and again a similar support you can see. So it took a proper support, jumped back. Technically also, I see this as a wonderful buy. There are few chart, so few candlestick patterns which have also been formed in this last part. So this is typically close to a bullish engulfing candle. It's not a proper bullish engulfing candle, but it's very close to that. Even this pattern is like a Morningstar candle pattern which has been formed. Of course, I have not talked about these candlestick patterns in my YouTube videos because this is just my third video on technical analysis, which I'm putting on YouTube. But if you wish to know more on technical analysis, I'm taking a live batch in Pune right now, which is being recorded and which will be available to you on the first week of January. I've done a lot of analysis on that. I have talked about in detail what is a Morningstar candle, what is bullish engulfing candle. That'll be available for you all by first week of January. But as of now, I told you fundamental analysis, yes, seems to be a little bit pricey, no doubts on that. But always remember that if the growth is good, if the growth story is good, we saw that it's gaining in market share as well. Fundamentally looks good. Technically also looks definitely good. You can add on few more points for technical analysis as well, like MACD, RSI, test all these levels. And if that be so, I feel it's a good buy. It has grown, it has gone up a long way. Like I guess this could be from 1774 to, oh, that's like 100 points move, 100 rupees move in a single day. So I feel there's a good strength, which I still can see in DMart. It can be a good buy, but definitely do a good analysis at your end as well. I hope you have enjoyed both the analysis, fundamental as well as technical. Do let me know if you want more such analysis, which combine both fundamental and technical. As always, my disclaimer that of course, whatever view I'm telling you, that's completely my view. I am not registered with SEBI. I'm not allowed to give any direct buy or sell a call on that. But it's my education which I'm trying to give you, my strategy, my analysis which I'm trying to put forth to you. Do consider first do your own studies, ask your investment advisor also, and then invest into these stocks. I hope you're liking my videos. If you are liking the videos, just don't forget to hit the like button and comment below if you want me to make videos on any other topic. That's it from my side. Jai Hind. Bye-bye.